If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. There's a man who woke up one morning in 1888. His name was Alfred, and he woke up to read his own obituary. The notice was printed as a result of a simple journalistic error, because it was actually Alfred's brother who had died, and the reporter carelessly reported the death of the wrong brother. That would be interesting. To Alfred, the shock was overwhelming because he saw himself the way the world saw him. The world saw him as the dynamite king. The great industrialist who had made an immense fortune from explosives. This, as far as the general public was concerned, was the entire purpose of Alfred and his life. None of his true intentions to break down the barriers that separated men and ideas for peace were recognized or given serious consideration in the article. He was simply the merchant of death. And for that alone, he would be remembered. As he read the obituary with horror, he resolved to make clear to the world that the true meaning and the purpose that he had for what he wanted his life to be, that this could be done through the final disposition of his fortune, which was very wealthy. His last will and testament would be an expression of his own life and his own ideals. And it's the only reason we still remember him today. The result of the most valuable of prizes that was given to those who have done the most for the cause of world peace. We know it today as it is called the Nobel Peace Prize, because the man's name was Alfred Nobel, who had created it. My brother's here, so he can tell you everything you need to know, that he and I grew up in San Diego, California for a while, and I remember my dad dropping us off at, and my brother and my friends dropped us off at the beach there in San Diego area and one of the public beaches there for the Pacific Ocean. The problem was is that the Pacific can many times be very cold. And so it was cold, and so we decided that instead of going in the water, we would go on the beach and begin to make sandcastles, by which we would also be toasted by the sun at that time. But we made walls, tunnels, roads, moats, all sorts of stuff, until the waves came in, and away it goes, and it washed it all away. You are all familiar with that. You've all been there, you've all done that. I want you to know that the reality is that it may feel like every day, at the end of the day, that everything that you've done is now done and gone away. And many times on this earth, it seems like the things that we do get washed away. But what's happening really is that you are doing something and you are building what I want to say, this is what we're going to talk about today, building a legacy for all eternity. They're listed on the back of your bulletin, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. The scriptures are also found in your scripture reading that's in the bulletin. God has placed a deep desire within all of our hearts to live a life that matters in making a lasting mark on the earth. So here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, the passage that we looked at, if a man builds on a foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. And it will be revealed by fire as to test the quality of that person's life. This passage says that every day of my life, I'm building something. I'm building a legacy, and every moment of every day, I get to choose what materials that I'm going to build with. What am I going to use? And I can build with temporary stuff, or I can build with eternal things. But if I'm going to build a legacy, there are only three materials that you can use. There's only three materials that you can build with. And these three materials that are listed on the back of your bulletin. The first one, number one, is convictions. Convictions are those core values from God's word that never change. Convictions are eternal. Isaiah chapter 40, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. We know that trends, styles, they come and go. God's word never changes. We know that pop psychology is changing. God's word never changes. The bestseller book list changes practically week to week, but God's word never changes. It is the truth today. It was the truth 1,000 years ago. It will be the same truth 1,000 years from now. Someone I heard just this past week said some parts of the Bible are less inspired than others. No, that's a human reaction. It's all inspired by God's Holy Spirit. My convictions have come from the Word of God. My core values come from God's Word, and they don't change. They are rock solid within a shaky world, but I have to live them out for them to be convictions. I like the way the Message translation says in Matthew chapter 7, but if you just use my words in Bible study and don't work them out in your life, then you're like a stupid carpenter that builds his house on a sandy beach. He's saying don't just study the Bible, you've got to put it in your life. In other words, it has to form a conviction in your life. It isn't becoming a conviction unless you live it out in your life. Now, you may have a picture up there of Arnold Schwarzenegger. Arnold Schwarzenegger has a book called Encyclopedia of Modern Bodybuilding. Now, it would be interesting to me if one of you came up to me and said, and you gave me that book. And you say, well, Pastor, I know you're exercising and I know you're trying to get in shape, but I wanted you to take this book, and the whole church has decided that we're just going to give you 6 months off, and we want you to just really try, and we want a pastor that looks like Arnold. Okay. Really what you're saying is, my pastor can beat your pastor up. So I said, well, okay, that's great, you know, and that's wonderful. So I take the 6 months off, I come back, and you're all excited, and the great day has finally arrived. You anticipate what the pastor is going to look like, Arnold. And I walk on stage, and this is what I look like. And you say, how disappointing. You might say to me, Pastor, you mean you didn't go to the gym? No, I didn't go to the gym. I was busy studying the book. I was studying the Arnold book. You didn't eat right? No, I didn't. I ate. What do you mean? You didn't do anything that's in the book? No, I read the book. I studied the book. In fact, I even highlighted parts of it. Some of the parts about Arnold's life and when he was a kid were very moving. I almost cried. I mean, and you say, well, Pastor, didn't you do what was in the book? Oh, yeah, I read the book. It's my favorite book. I love the book. I read it 6 times. I read it once a month. It's amazing. I memorized 2 chapters about the workout plan. I can say it word for word. And you would think, well, that's silly, wouldn't you? But there's a lot of believers that do the same thing with the Word of God. They go to Bible studies over and over, and they come here week after week, and they hear the preaching, but they don't put what is said into action. They don't live it out. It's not a conviction. I mean, you can know the Bible from cover to cover, but if you don't live it out, then you really don't believe it. A belief is something that you hold on to, but a conviction is something that has a hold on you. You see, a conviction is core values from God's word. They are anchors that hold us, that permeate our lives, and they become a part of us. It becomes just who I am. We live it out each day. That's what a conviction ought to do. A conviction is something that is eternal. If you're going to build a lasting legacy, you have to build convictions into your life. Number two, there's a second thing, and that is character. God cares about your character. God cares about my character, because when you die, the only thing that you can take with you is you can't take a lot, but you can take your character with. You take that character with you when you go to glory. Romans 8:29, God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. You see, from the very beginning, God has always had a plan. And his plan for you and his plan for me is that you and I would become more and more like Jesus. The plan is to put into your life the very character of Christ himself. He wants to build into your life the very character of his son, Jesus. It's interesting, you see a picture of the great sculptor Michelangelo was once asked, how did you sculpt the famous David? And Michelangelo's answer was, well, I just chipped away everything that didn't look like David. It was that simple. And the reality is that's what Jesus Christ does in your life. He chips away everything in your character that doesn't look like Jesus. He chips away everything in my character, all my character faults and character flaws. They don't look like Jesus Christ. Because his plan is to make me more like him. His plan is to build my character. There are three tools. They're listed on the back of your bulletin there again. First one is the thing that you're going to have is problems. Problems. If you're a believer, problems always have a purpose. Sometimes God allows little problems into your life, those little irritations that kind of rub off. And many times they are the ones that rub off the rough edges in your life. Other times he allows huge problems in your life. That's when he gets out the jackhammer and he starts chipping away the huge chunks. This doesn't look like Jesus. This isn't what Jesus. And our problems always make me more like Jesus. But if I have the right attitude in the problem, then it should direct me toward what Jesus would do. The second thing is that of pressures. We learn patience under pressure. The most Christ-like people I've ever known were people who were under tremendous pressure. Because pressure always brings out the best or the worst in us. Pressure. The third thing is that God uses people. God uses people like a tool to sort of chisel away the rough edges that are in your character. Every one of us has people in our lives that irritate us, that get under our skin, that rub us the wrong way. Some of you have those people right in your own family. Somebody said they are heavenly sandpaper. God uses them to rub off the rough edges that are taking place in our lives. And God uses these tools because God wants to build his character in you so that we can build a lasting legacy, so that we can make a mark on our earth, that we can make a difference in the world that we are living in. But then there is a third thing. Let's go to number three. It is community. God's word lasts forever. Godly convictions, godly character lasts forever. And God's people last forever. That's why it's so important to be in a relationship with other believers. I think, you know, whether it's a Sunday school class, whether it's a Bible study group, to be together with them, to grow together. That we're desiring in every way to go the same direction. We want to go the way God wants us to go. Now, in Luke chapter 10, there's a passage that you have in your scripture there is two ladies named Mary and Martha. And Mary and Martha in Luke chapter 10 are friends of Jesus. One night, he is invited over to their house. He comes over to their house for dinner, and we see what Martha is doing. Martha is running around and frenzy trying to make sure everything is perfect because the Son of God is there. But Mary is sitting at Jesus' feet conversing with God's Son. Now, I feel in some ways that this is not a sermon that I should preach. I think one of you women should come up and preach this one. Because I believe every one of you women have been in this situation. Because what happens is that Martha looks at Mary and she gets angry. And then who does she get angry at? She gets angry at Jesus. Jesus, why aren't you correcting this? And Jesus is just there. He's not setting it straight. And he wasn't looking out for her needs. And so she comes to Jesus and looks what she says in Luke 10. Martha was distracted. She came to him and asked the Lord, "Do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her." She doesn't beat around the bush. "Tell her, Lord. Get with the program here. Tell her to help me." What does the Lord do? He answers her by saying, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and you're distracted by many things. But there is need of only one thing, and Mary has chosen the better part." Now, when you're running around doing supper, is that the passage you want read to you during that time? And okay, just, you know what comes to me when you look at this and you say, Lord, right in the ribs, you know, with the knife, and it had to hurt. It had to hurt. And Martha is thinking, look, what do you mean? Look at all that I'm doing here. She's chosen the better part. I'm working as hard as I can, and look what she's doing, Lord. Look what you're letting her do. I know you're God's son, but why don't you tell her what she needs to do here? Are you catching on what's going on here in the application to your own life? Jesus kindly and sweetly tells Martha, "You're missing the boat. You know your priorities, but your priorities are wrong. Martha, Mary is doing the thing that's important. She's doing the thing that will last for eternity." In other words, he's saying, you're making the Christian life too complicated. It's really pretty simple. It's all about a relationship with me. It's a relationship with the Lord, and then it's a relationship with other people. And that's what Jesus is saying here. Don't feel guilty about spending time with God and getting refreshed spiritually. And don't feel guilty about spending time with others in fellowship and growing together as a group, together in the Lord. You need that so you can be that person that God wants you to be. It's important to refresh your spiritual needs so that then you can meet the needs of other folks. There was a sand sculpture expert who did sculptures of sand on sand in different parts of the country, whether it's on the East Coast or the West Coast. And they asked him, what's the number one question that you get asked about being a sand sculptor? And he says, don't you get discouraged that you're building something, that you are working so hard on something, and that it's just going to be torn down? Don't you ever feel discouraged that all you're building and doing is just going to be washed away out to sea? And he said, no, not at all. He said, along with others that were a part of this, he said, we love the process. They said, it's not the finished product that is so satisfying, but it is the process in doing it. It's doing all the creative work and the feeling so satisfied and the using of our gifts of artists' work. And it's the relationships also that we develop and fellowship that we have together. It's so much fun to do this together. They said, that's what gives us the most joy. So we could care less that it's going to get knocked down, because that's not the point. But that's the way life is. You know that castle you live in, that house you live in? It's a sandcastle. It's going to get knocked down. Don't get too attached to it. Enjoy it. It's great. It's fine. But it's what goes on inside that makes it important. It's not your house that's important, it's your home that's important. It's your family that's important. You see, it's just a sandcastle, it's just going to get knocked down, so don't get too attached to it. The car you drive is a sandcastle, don't get too attached to it. It's going to be knocked down one day, or rust away. Don't get too attached. In other words, everything you own on this earth, God says, enjoy them, they're fine, they're good, just don't get attached and hooked into them. Because that's not where life is. They're just sandcastles. It's the relationships that you have that matter, and your relationship with God, your relationship with God's Son, and your relationship with other folks. That's what matters. That's what's going to last. That's when all is said and done, will last for eternity. Let me close. In 1997, a guy named Mitch Albom wrote an international bestseller. It was titled Tuesdays with Maury. If you've never heard of Mitch Albom, it's interesting. He was just in the news because he was flown out of Haiti as he was trying to help down there in a home that he has started to help children down in that area of Haiti. In that book, he chronicles a writer's reunion himself with his old college professor. His college professor is a man named Maury Schwartz. He learned about his professor having a debilitating bout with ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease. The two men would spend 14 Tuesdays together. Each of the visits would constitute a chapter in the book, in what is now one of the best-selling memoirs in all time. On the eighth Tuesday, Albom brought a newspaper telling about Ted Turner and Ted Turner's frustration in not being able to buy or to acquire CBS TV network. Turner was quoted as saying in the newspaper, "I don't want my tombstone to read, I never owned a network." The ensuing conversation that took place after that related to the aspect of giving or taking or acquiring. And as it drew to a close, Maury explained why he is so interested in talking with people about their life, even though his own life is little by little ebbing away. He said, "I'm dying, right? Why do you think it's so important for me to hear other people's problems? I mean, don't I have enough pain and suffering of my own? Of course I do. But giving to other people is what makes me feel alive. Not my car, not my house, not what I look like in the mirror. When I give my time, when I can make someone smile, when after they have been feeling sad, it's as close to healthy as I ever feel. There to be of support and help to someone else." Just think about it. Everything you own is a sandcastle. It's all coming down. But as we've said here, there are three things that are going to last: your convictions, your character, your community and relationships with others. God's word, God's character, God's people. Those are the only three things that are going to last. Everything we have on this earth will be washed away. The moment you die, you don't take anything with you except your convictions, your character, and yourself. They last forever. People live forever, either in heaven or in hell. And we have to choose whether or not we want the relationship with God's Son. We have to choose on this earth whether we want to make a difference in this life. We have to choose whether we want to relate to others and build relationships. We have to make the choice. But just thinking about it, every one of us, everything we own, everything is going to be washed away. It's going to be completely gone. And there's only three things that will really last. What kind of legacy do you want to leave? Let's bow in prayer. We thank you, our gracious God, for your salvation that has been given to us in Christ. We thank you that you have given yourself, but then you have also shown us the way. Just as you desired for Martha, that we would choose the closeness of the relationship with you, and that that will last for eternity. Lord God, we ask that you would give us wisdom. We pray for those things that are so temporary here, that many of those things that are the problems or the pressures or the people, but that you can use that to make us and conform us to be like you. We ask, Lord, for your continued guidance, for your continued wisdom. And may we understand as we begin this Holy Week that we have remembrance that our Savior, Jesus Christ, gave himself for us, and that he loved us so much that he wants to spend eternity with us. Lord, we thank you for that. Ask your blessing upon this in every way, that we will be reminded of what our God has done. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.